of you got here, I was goofing off on Vince's guitar. And you can realize that pretty quickly that that's not what I do. Especially since
it's
I had...
Great. It's good coverage.
Don't tell them that. I'll be the only one here. I do... I'm horrible at it, honestly. But I don't practice it. I tried in the past because I thought it was like the youth pastor thing. When you were a youth pastor, you're supposed to have a goatee and play guitar, right? And make funny jokes. And so I tried to do all that. I had a goatee. People laughed at my jokes. I think they felt bad for me. But the guitar thing never came through. So, but I value our worship and just music. I listen to it a lot in the evenings before I go to bed, in the mornings, kind of start my day. I love it, but I was just thinking, we are so blessed to have people that are willing to commit their time and energy, their weekends, preparing for this, and just their willingness to use their gifts to glorify God and lead us in a time where we can celebrate what God's doing. So thank you guys for doing that each week. I've noticed right now there are kind of two kinds of people in the room. Kind of have our front row people. We have our way in the back people. Can you hear me? All right? I need somebody to move to just one center seat here. This feels like maybe I need to stand in the middle here and talk to all of you. But this morning, as we are enjoying our time here, Justin and his family are enjoying their time. I know it's probably miserable, but they're on the beach, you know. I may or may not have prayed for him to get a sunburn. but they're there enjoying some family time together. And Justin asked me to share, honestly, really talking about a kind of a topic that's been on my heart for a long time, and I haven't known personally how to handle it. So I've not shared it with you guys. But this morning we're going to look at whenever God seems uncooperative. When we know God could do something, we believe that he will, and then he doesn't. What do we do with that? Like, how do we handle that? I'll tell you right now, before we get started, I don't have an answer for it. But I do know it starts with prayer. And I think if we view and have a perspective on prayer and what prayer can provide for us, I think we can handle these situations where we feel like God's not cooperating with our requests. I think we can handle that a little bit better. So, I want you to think about that. We want to talk about that this morning. An example would be kind of like when this would happen without God. It's like when your spouse, you've asked maybe to take out, let's say, this might have happened a time or two at my house, to take out the trash, let's say, okay? And then you don't take out the trash, and your spouse knows that you can take out the trash. They believe that you will take out the trash, but then you don't take out the trash. How disappointing and frustrating is that, right? Okay, so in a similar situation, we can kind of find ourselves there with God. A friend of mine, or a pastor I know, shared this story one time. They were on their honeymoon. They just got married. Sharing this like 20 years after, but they had just gotten married, come back from their honeymoon, and the ACs broke in their house. And this guy's not confident in all in his abilities to fix it. He has no clue what he's doing with it, okay? But the wife says, well, we'll go out and look, and you know, he's the new husband, so he's doing the husband thing, and he kind of looks around at the AC unit. Kind of kicks it a little bit, shakes it a little bit, checks some wires, walks back in and says, honey, I think it's above my pay grade. And so she asked me, well, have you prayed over it? You know, and this is a pastor, and he was a pastor at the time, and he said, well, no, it seems like a silly thing to do. So the newlywed wife says, well, I think you should pray over it. So he goes out, his retelling of the story is, he's like, well, when sick people, you lay hands on sick people in the Bible, this AC is obviously sick, so maybe I should lay my hand on it. And he said, that just didn't seem right. It felt like he was supposed to raise his other hand to God, so So he's got the AC unit outside, his hand up. Before he puts his hands up, he's looking around to make sure nobody else is going to see him, and he prays over it. And while he's praying, that thing starts up. Okay, so they've been there a couple hours, and it starts. So he's like, that thing was not working, and I prayed over it, and it started working. So we have sometimes things like that that God answers our prayers on, right? Maybe a parking spot, you're stressed, you're late, you got to get a gift, and you're already late to the birthday party or wedding or whatever, and you're like, oh God, I just need a real close parking spot, it's raining really hard, please give me, and a parking spot appears, right? We have those times where simple, silly, almost, like, why are we even praying about this thing? Prayers are answered. Kendra, before JC was born, Kendra was consistently praying for JC to be creative. Just a creative soul, and I was talking to Kendra this week about it, and she says, I might not have prayed to have prayer if I knew what that was going to turn out to be. We have like a little hoarder in our house. Any cereal box is turned into a Barbie doll bed, or a house, or something. We have like, her room is like just random things that she's remade, crafty-wise, remade into other things. You know, God answers our prayers, but then there are times that he doesn't. You know, my dad passed away from cancer. I can guarantee you, I remember the night that we came to my house, and we laid hands on him, and we prayed for him. You know, and he died from cancer. He didn't answer that prayer that we were asking for. But he answered Kendra's prayer about JC being creative. He answered this pastor I know about his AC unit being fixed. And he's answered our other silly prayers in life. So how do we handle that? It can be super frustrating. And we can feel left hopeless when things that really, really matter, we don't feel like God answers. And then other times he answers. Or he answers it for other people and not us. How do we handle that? How do we process that? Why would God do some things so insignificant and not do some things that are important to us? I'm sure we all have that. I just kind of shared you a couple from my life, but you have those similar situations where silly prayers have been answered and really important prayers in your life seem to kind of be unanswered, or it just doesn't seem to be going with what you think ought to happen. How do we handle that? Maybe it's something as simple as a parking spot, but then you have migraine headaches that refuse to go away, or some kind of other health. Maybe you're praying for a marriage, your marriage, or somebody else's marriage, and it doesn't seem like it's getting any better. Maybe you've got ongoing pain or a challenge in your life or a job, you're praying for a job to change or something, and it doesn't seem to be answered. Whatever it is, almost all of us have that same kind of situation where we're kind of saying, God, I believe you can do this. I'm coming to you because I believe you'll hear me and you can do this. I'm praying that you will, and yet, God, you haven't. We've been there. Maybe some of us are there today, whether it's healing or a restoration or a job or getting into a certain school or pain or countless of things. Nothing's happened. Nothing's happening with our prayer. Today, we're going to look at Paul a little bit and his story, one specific story he has that he shares in 2 Corinthians. We're going to look at that here in a little bit. But I want us to think about our prayer and how prayer can change our outlook. Three different thoughts and about prayer, the hope we can have in that prayer. So let's read 2 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to start at verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. We're going to start with therefore. Just a little bit of background here. Paul's sharing, and he basically, before he shares this in the first few verses of this chapter, he's saying, I could brag. I could brag because I've suffered a lot. I've done a lot for God. I could brag, but I don't want to brag. Okay, it's kind of where he's at. And so then he shares this. Therefore, in order to keep me from being conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will not boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. There are some things that I want us to talk about, three things that I think really help us with this as we look at the scripture. The first one, and we're going to kind of go back over the scripture this morning that I just read. The first one is true prayer isn't about getting our way. When we go to pray, it's not about getting our way. It's surrendering our will. It's not about getting God to do what we want. You know, so often, the majority of the time, my prayers are to convince God of what I want, what I think I need. But it's more about surrendering our will to what God actually wants. Jesus prayed this in the garden before he was betrayed, before he went to the cross and died. He said it this way, Father, if there's any way, would you remove this cup of suffering from me? He's asking God, if there's any other way than going to the cross, would you please choose that? If there's any other way for salvation to happen for us, beyond Jesus having to suffer, he's asking God to choose it. But then he goes on and says, nevertheless, God, not my will, but what? Your will be done. It's not about getting our way. It's about surrendering our will to what God wants. Jesus taught us to pray when the disciples asked him, teach us how to pray. Part of that, he says, thy will be done. God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not our will, but God's will. The true prayer isn't about getting God to do what we want to do. It's often surrendering our will to what God wants. Now, Paul had this kind of first take example of his life. And if anybody deserved an answer prayer, it would be Paul. A little bit about Paul, just to remind ourselves. He hated believers. He persecuted believers. He was a part of making sure believers weren't killed. And then he was saved. He ended up writing about half the New Testament. And for what we just read from, visions, he raised the dead. He traveled for 20 years on ship, sharing the gospel. He's part of bringing the gospel to Europe. Started countless churches. A lot of good things for God, right? A lot of good things. I mean, his whole life was about doing what God wanted him to do after he accepted Christ. But he also paid a price. He was imprisoned. He was shipwrecked. He was whipped five different times. And just a little bit, as I read in preparing for this, the law said that you could be whipped 39 times. If you got whipped 40 times and you died from it, that person was held accountable for your death. So he got whipped 39 times, five different times in his life. Now you got to believe, I've had shoulder surgery and elbow surgery in the past year. And going into my elbow surgery, I kind of knew what my recovery was going to be like, right? My shoulder was recent enough. I knew what I was getting into for the most part. I was ready to get it over with, honestly. Like, I wasn't looking forward to having another month's worth of feeling bad and not being able to help out around the house or pick up my kids or do that kind of thing, be limited to what my daily life was. I got to believe after the scars and wounds healed one time, maybe two times, third, fourth, and fifth time, you weren't really looking forward to, here we go again, I'm about to have 39 lashes. He was beaten, he was stoned, he was left for dead. They thought he was dead. They left him to die. He was mostly dead. He didn't deserve all that. He lived a life for God, but yet, towards his end of his life, he would have thought, this would be good. Paul served a good time. It's time for him to just kind of settle in and live out his life. He served God for a long, long time, took a lot of punishment. But in the scripture we just read, in the first part, verse 7 said this, therefore, in order to keep me from being conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Now, the word thorn in the Bible talks about, it kind of refers to a stake that was used to stab through people to make sure that they were dead. So, this is the word he's using. I have a thorn in my side. Now, we don't know, like, what kind of physical ailment or did he have, you know, issues going on. He had something that was tormenting him. Okay, and so he says, it's tormenting me so that I won't be conceited. I won't be all about me. Maybe you've got arthritis or headaches or depression or have a hard time sleeping or an addiction. Something in you, right? You're asking for help. You're so tired of this ailment, this thorn in your side. Paul's saying, this was given to me. God allowed it to happen to me. It tormented me, but God used it to keep me from being conceited. Now, if you have headaches all the time, I'm not saying God's using that to make sure you're not conceited about yourself. But Paul's recognizing something bad is happening to him so that something good comes out of it. So that God, he doesn't get in the way of what God's wanting to do. I think the other thing prayer can remind us of is prayer reminds us that we're not in control. It keeps us close to the one that is in control. In the scripture it says, three times I pleaded to God to take this away from me. Because he went to God in prayer, he was really close to him. He pleaded. This isn't like 3 days in a row I asked for prayer. This is like three seasons of my life. I was begging God to take this away from me. It wasn't like I was sick for 3 days and I needed some help. This is like three seasons worth of prayer where he was asking God, begging God, will you take this away from me? Now, I think about our lives where we have seasons where we're begging God to take something away or to provide something for us. Parents' marriage or a child's marriage, maybe, or you're praying for a child, or you're praying for somebody with addictions, or yourself, maybe, somebody that's got sickness. How we beg for God to intercede and change that, don't we? And sometimes it feels like God's not answering. He's not working with what our pleading is. And Paul's doing the same thing. He says, I beg, please take this away from me. But here's what God says in verse 9. God said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. So he's saying, no, my grace is good enough. You can stick with this. Paul's saying, help me, change my circumstance, fix my problem, relieve my pain. And God says, no, my grace is good enough. We say sometimes, this is what I need. And God says, no, I'm what you. God's kind of saying, I could do that. I've done it before. Done it for you before. I've done it for other people before. And I may do something about it later. But in this, right now, right here, you're going to experience me in a way that you could not if I took that away or I changed that circumstance. It's kind of hard to explain, honestly. But I do have a story in my life where this kind of happened. It's happened multiple times. I'm going to share one that I can get through emotionally without bawling my eyes out in front of you guys this morning. I moved back from Louisville, and it wasn't an easy situation. Kendra lost her job. She had a major pay cut. We had to do something different. We had a mortgage that depended on both of us having an income. So somebody to rent our house. I moved in with a buddy. Kendra moved back in with mom and dad. Back in this way. I'm living in Louisville. We have an 8-month-old baby. Not ideal for how we wanted to move back. We've been praying for years that God, please give us an opportunity to move back. And it really kind of seemed like God was uncooperative with that. And then he provides, and it's not quite what I intended. I learned to be a little more specific in my prayer. So we end up, as adults with a baby, moving back in with my parents. You know, a humbling to experience that to depend on somebody else. And so I stay up there and finish a job, and Kendra gets a job, and then I quit mine, and I'm looking for a job. I bounce around from little job to little job. I have a college degree, and I can't use it, so I'm bouncing around. We finally land on our feet. I decide to go back to school, and I want to become a teacher. Now I'm enrolled in school, and I can become a teacher now. And a job opens up here at this middle school. Actually, two jobs for exactly what I'm going to school for. And so that summer, I'm super excited. I get a phone call. I've applied for those jobs. I get a phone call for an interview. I'm really excited. Just everything seems to be just lining up. Like I spent 1 year in Owensboro working, and now I'm going to be in Hancock County where I wanted to be. Everything's going to work out perfect. And so they call me for this interview, and it happens to be the same time I'm in St. Louis on a mission trip with high schoolers. So they want to interview me on Friday. Now, we left on Sunday. I slept in a church on a floor. I'm enrolled in my college classes because I'm going back to be a teacher. I still have classes, so when kids are going to sleep about 10 o'clock, I go upstairs to the church to get internet to work on my paper that's due on Friday. Okay, so I've done this every night, all day. You know how mission trips are if you don't. It's like all day long. You wake up at 7, you have breakfast, you do worship, you do devotions, you go out and work all day in the heat. It was in the summer in St. Louis. Nonstop. We come back to showers. We have dinner. We have more worship time. There's like no free time. Keep the kids entertained and going all the time. It's tons of fun, but it is exhausting. And then I'm doing school on top. And so I asked them if they could maybe meet on Saturday, that I would be back Friday evening late. I could interview on Saturday or Sunday or Monday, any day. And they said, no, we'll just do a phone interview with you on Friday morning at 8 a.m. After me staying up from like 7 a.m. to 1 a.m. all week long, doing the mission trip, doing all that work, I'm exhausted. My voice was about as low as it could be, mumbling that morning. And I did a phone interview for this job that I felt like I was lining up for me. So really stressed about that coming week. So as I'm praying about it, there is just this incredible amount of peace I'm getting, like, it's going to work out. 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 And I'm like, oh, I'm scared to death that it's not going to work out. Now, why do I have this peace about it? So I prayed that night as I'm sitting in my paper Thursday night at about midnight. I'm praying, God, please don't let me wake up feeling this way if I'm not going to get this job. Don't give me this peace about it. I wake up. Feeling more peaceful about everything in the world. I'm like, all right, this is going to be a cool story. I'm going to get this interview on a mission trip. I'm going to get this job, and it'll be great. I do the interview. I think they hear me. My voice is so long. I'm not sure they understood everything I was saying, but I'm probably slurring my words more than ever. But I get a phone call on Monday, and I didn't get the job. Either one. And I had this incredible peace. So frustrating. Well, about a week later, I've applied to a job from Owensboro. They've offered me a job. I've kind of gone through the emotional why I didn't understand. God didn't seem to be working with my schedule or cooperating with what I was asking him. But I got a job, and I'm kind of working through that. So I got a job offer, and I also, that same day, a posting came up for a third special ed job at Little Old Hancock County Middle School. They only have three positions here at the time. And all three of them came open in one summer. So at this point, we're right before school. And I apply and I get that job. But there was so much time in that that I didn't feel like God was cooperating. God was going to give me what I thought I needed. But I had some peace about it the entire time. And I think it's about this third thing. It reminded me I wasn't in control. God was going to do it the way God wanted to, right? But it also reminded me about this. Prayer isn't just about asking. It's about trusting God. Right? I'm sure you've had stories just like mine where you felt like you were asking God, but you weren't trusting. Not just asking for what you want, but trusting God knows what's best. Right? Paul's looking back in his story, realizing the thorn, the suffering is a good thing. He says, therefore, I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight. He's delighting in his weakness, in his insults, in the hardships, in the persecution, and difficulties. Because he knows for when he is weak, he's his strongest, because he's depending on God the most. So, kind of to wrap this up, when you feel like God's not cooperating with you, and you're very persistent in your prayer with whatever's going on in your life or your family's life, think of prayer this way, these three things. It's not about getting your way. It's surrendering to God's will in your life. It's remembering that God's in control. We're not. And it's not just about asking. It's about, will you really trust God with whatever that is? Will you really trust saying, not my will, God, but yours, because I know you know what's best for me and my family. It's not an easy place to get to, but I think when we get to that place in life with God, when we can say, not my will, but yours, God, because I know you know what's best, there's that peace that I talked about that doesn't make sense. It's unexplainable, but we can all have it. We can all have it. When we're willing to say, not my will, but yours, God, I'm trusting in you in this situation. I don't know how it's going to turn out. It might not turn out the way I want it to be, but God, I know you know what's best. I'm trusting that. That's a beautiful place to be. Let's pray. God, we love you, but the reality is sometimes you don't make any sense to us how you work. God, help us to just step out as we pray, knowing that we're praying not only to ask a request and believe that you can do it and know that you can, but also know you know what's best. That we're going to ask for healing. We're going to ask for miracles to be done, God. But ultimately, God, you know what's best. So whether it's right now, God, or in the future, when we have thorns in our sides and we're suffering through a situation where we see family suffering, God, may we just be reminded that you know what's best. May we allow your will to